Could I offer one or two thoughts about where I feel that Orwell wasn't a problem before we open up? There's that moment, you're stating that David, in one of his wartime essays, when he looks ahead to post-war Britain, which he trusts is going to be a peaceful socialist revolution. And he says, I think he lists four things, there'll be no more, and I can't remember four of them, I think I remember three of them, there'll be no more gentlemen players in matches of cricket.
It's goodbye to the world, maybe the Rolls Royce.
Well, and by that, the gentlemen players basically meant, you know, these sort of inexorable class divides.
Mm. Yes.
Well, there's still a split of class around in this country. We still have an educational divide between the private sector and the state sector. I think he would not have expected 60 years later.
Although he did send his son to a public school.
Yes. But he, yes, I'm not saying that he wouldn't have expected
no, to continue. No,
he would have. He forecast the end of country houses, which we have become holiday homes, I think you're very positive.
I think, I think from, in terms of Orwell's psychology, I think this is all just whistling in the dark at this point, because the great paradox to me about is that here is this totemic archetypal left-wing radical figure. Yes. Who is taking away the politics and everything else? The idea that you actually wanted to turn into politics.
No, sorry, I'm not talking about one.
No, but I don't believe that. I don't think you see. I think that most of it is actual political. I don't believe in the other thought that there would be an end to the public houses.
So he didn't think, my third example, he didn't. So he made a bridge.
I don't think you knew enough about it. He had that characteristic
yes.
of writer's view yes. of the city based on complete ignorance of what
actually happened. Okay, so actually, more than that, David. So, the stock exchange is our symbol of capitalism.
Yes,
it probably means a very good symbol of capitalism. Today in the Guardian, there was an interesting article by Geoffrey Wheatcroft, basically about the end of socialism is utterly and completely dead in a way that. Generation or two would not have seen possible to assert that in such in such a blunt way. I don't think that Orwell would have expected that. I feel that he would not have expected the inexorable. I don't think he would have expected, anticipated the inexorable rise of individualism and consumerism. We now live in. You could argue, you've just been reviewing a book on it, but actually in the 30s, when he wasn't around observing, but actually in many parts of the country, there were pockets of deep, deep unemployment and misery. 30s. There were many other areas that were actually not well in the 30s.
Oh, there were.
And actually, that is, you start to see that individualism and consumerism coming through.
There's a very interesting.
He doesn't really extrapolate.
No, he doesn't. There's a very, just before he died, there's a very interesting diary towards the end, but he's in the sanatorium, where he comes across, it must have been a copy of Vogue or something like that, some transatlantic sort of fashion magazine. And he's completely appalled by it. He said, I've been through this, and there is not one photograph of anybody who was old or, you know, and yet that was unfortunate. Well, you know, let's not be judgmental. That was the future. And Orwell's good, it was completely uncomprehending.
Yes.
It seems to Pete Davidson, who edited Orwell's complete works in 20 volumes, and once actually made a list of all the things that he thought that Orwell had got right. It was quite detailed. It was things like deforestation, containing superpowers, the dissemination of pornography to the proletariat, this kind of. It made a good paragraph.
Yes.
But they're not. I suppose I. We ought to work with this factor.
Yes.
I suppose the thing that really, I suppose, concerns me is the linguistic aspect of it.
Yeah.
And, whenever you see a phrase like collateral damage, you think, well, notice that. He would have said something about that.
Yeah. I think he would have been deeply unhappy. That's not meant to be particularly philosophical, but you can deal with that about the mode of conduct of politics in the new Labour era. The twisting of that.
It's interesting because Anthony Cole, who was a right winger, a very, very friend of him, and like him, very important, he'd been to Eton and, you know, had that kind of service military background behind him. Poll said, oh yes, he's been happy. So Orwell would have been anti-CND, he'd been in favour of the invasion of Falkland Islands. And you cannot make these guesses. But I would make that point. Apart from the politics, he was deeply concerned.
But he did have passionate feelings about a sort of discourse of politics. And something has happened to that discourse. It's not just in the way that goes back to the earlier, but something has happened which, usually Norwegian prisoners is quite sinister.
Yes, I suppose. Whereas you meet with today's politicians, compared to Brown and Darling, Macmillan and his Chancellor, like moral titans.
Relative speaking, but